Joining us on the line now is Jeff Sharlet. You know him. He's an author. He's a journalist. He's a professor of writing at Dartmouth. And he's got a brand new book out that I am just loving. It's called This Brilliant Darkness, A Book of Strangers. And I actually, Jeff, I reached out to you last week. I had the book here, but obviously we've been all in this other world dealing with the coronavirus and everything else. And frankly, I've been in this weird place where I don't want to deal with business as usual. But I did read a post that you put up on Facebook about when Bernie Sanders suspended his campaign, and you so echoed my thoughts perfectly. That I had to reach out, and I thought, oh my goodness, I'd forgotten your new book. We haven't even spoken about that yet. So I figured we'd, kill two birds and get stoned and talk about both of them. So welcome to the show. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you, Nicole. It's always good to be with you.
It's always great to talk with you. And you know, I'm such a big fan of yours. Let's start with the news, with Bernie Sanders withdrawing from the race. Of course, we're actually taping this on Tuesday. It's going to air on Wednesday, and we're taping it on Tuesday because on Wednesday you do homeschooling duties for your kids, yes?
Yeah.
It's a whole new world, really.
I get Mondays and Wednesdays, and we split Fridays, and Tuesdays is for my own work.
How old are your kids, if you don't mind me asking?
6 and 11, a first grader and a fifth grader.
Oh, boy. So you're right in the thick of it. How's the teaching going?
I actually think this is a political story we should be talking more about if you would let me answer at greater length. And I think it's an interesting thing in that we're being reminded of how much of our economy depends on the socialist structure of public education. And the reality that we're asking people to do their jobs, and some of them can, and some of them have kids to educate. Which we're not trained to do. I can teach college. I can't teach first grade. I don't know how to teach how to read. But it's also labor. And I think there's a weird disconnect. And I think the longer this goes on, the more we're going to start talking about what that is. And that might lead to finally teaching public school teachers, treating public school teachers with the respect they deserve. And I just... This is my hope, my prophecy, that's actually a huge political transformation that might come out of this pandemic.
You know, hopefully on a lot of levels, teachers now, parents are understanding the hard work that teachers put in every day if they didn't already know it. I'm seeing a lot of social media posts from parents who are now, you know, trying to teach their children, saying that teachers deserve huge raises, much more respect, better working conditions. I mean, things that we've known for years, but maybe it takes something like this to get the public at large to come to the table and realize we need to do much better by our teachers.
Well, and not only that, but also to respect, too, this big government, right? Public school is big government. It's socialism.
It
so, well, I don't want socialism. No, but wait a minute. You don't want socialism, but now your kids are at home all day. Oh, well, actually, maybe I will take a little bit of socialism, please, and have those schools. And I think we're not at that point yet. I mean, I know where I teach. I teach at a college. I have colleagues who don't have young kids. And then those of us who do. And we are proceeding as by the standard of those who are not dealing with young kids. And, you know, there's this attitude, well, look, you know, your kids are not my problem. I'm like, well, this economy is based on this, right? Yeah. So actually they are. My kids are your problem. And for everyone who's ever, you know, not wanted to vote for a school budget and so on because they don't have kids in the district, now you're going to find out what happens when you got that system.
Without a doubt. We're learning a lot of things during this quarantine. I guess that's what we're calling it, the stay-at-home period. The thing that keeps coming in my mind and taking over my thoughts is how this is such a unique situation. I mean, the entire world is in this together, unlike any other reality we've ever experienced before. We've had other worldwide events, but nothing on this magnitude where people from on one end of the planet to the other are kind of experiencing the same thing. I started doing something new on my show, Jeff, that you might appreciate. I call it quarantine calling, and I'm hooking up with people all over the world, in Denmark, in Italy, in Australia. I spoke to someone the other day. It was 5 o'clock in the morning there, 3 p.m. here the day before. Just connecting on a human level, and the fact that we're all in the same boat, this is something I don't think the planet has ever experienced before. And I think it's affecting us all, certainly in different ways. And we don't even know many of the ways that it's affecting us, because we probably won't know until it plays out in mental health issues in the coming months and years ahead of us.
Yeah, and we're still in the stage, I think, as a society, we're still in the stage of denial. And maybe that's our pivot point. You wanted to talk about Bernie and Biden.
Yep.
I think denial is a big word when we start talking about American politics right now. We're still sort of saying, well, how long till we can go back to normal? And then some of us are saying, well, no, we will never go back. That's, we've lost something.
Yeah.
You know, something has been lost. You can build something new. And as much as I think those of us on the left and liberals sort of want to say, oh, that's just right wingers doing it, anyone who's talking as if Democratic Party politics can return to normal is really just as delusional as the craziest MAGA bot, I think.
I agree. And so it was last week when Bernie Sanders, I think, surprised all of us by that day suspending his campaign. I mean, we knew it was eventually going to happen, but didn't know it was coming then. And you wrote a post saying, it may feel like too soon, but the hour is already late. And you go into, you're sending my first donation to the Biden campaign. But then you go in to say, I've despised Biden as long as I've known about him. And you talk about the reasons that you are not a supporter of his, but you realize the moment we're in our shared history, and realize that the need to oust Donald Trump from office is the greater good. I'm paraphrasing, obviously. I finished reading it. And I'm like, Jeff Sharlet does it again. You brilliantly verbalize what I was thinking. Yeah, I'm not a Biden fan in any form of the word. But I will vote for him in a vote against Donald Trump, because we've got to remove him from office. I know you got a lot of pushback from that post, huh?
I did, actually. Surprisingly, the worst pushback. I knew that there were going to be fellow Bernie supporters. I was a Warren supporter, Bernie supporter. Mm-hmm. And I knew there was going to be those people who were going to be upset. And some were not nearly sort of as angry and vulgar. I mean, there was more like, you know what, that's fine for you. Because I framed as like, look, this is what I'm doing. This is what I think we should do. If in your heart you can't do it, I respect that. And people are like, okay, I'm not going to do this. The real venom actually came from, and this is just so dismaying to me, from Biden supporters.
Huh.
And I've never blocked so many people on Facebook.
Yeah.
From Biden supporters who were furious. And I'm like, what more do you want? I'm giving money to your candidate. I'm right. Encouraging other people to vote for him. And they, not enough. They said, you're just as good as a Trump supporter.
Oh my God.
Because it is not enough to support him. I must love him. Now, the good news, those people are really annoying. I still do think they are the minority. That's a small thing. A lot of those people, they would talk about Hillary Clinton at the same time. And they seem to have conflated Biden and Hillary Clinton in their minds. And because I can understand, I wasn't a Hillary supporter either, mm-hmm. but I understand people who were, for whom that was so important. This was the closest that we could, you know, we had gotten to a woman as president. And that was certainly, you know, there was a case to be made. And so they sort of saw any criticism of Biden as like criticism of Hillary.
Yeah.
So there was some real, real pushback. But I think what you said at the beginning, you know, it's maybe too soon, but the hour is already late. That's the same situation that if we haven't learned that lesson from quarantine,
right.
Too soon to close schools. Well, we were too late closing schools, too soon to make that pivot to Biden. it's too late. We have to do it.
The thing, one of the things that really has me about Biden, forget about his politics, forget about his record for a moment, which, and I'm going to post your Facebook rant on the blog at NicoleSandler.com, where I post the podcast of today's show, because I think it's important that people read the whole thing for context. But there's another issue that now, just yesterday, finally, or over the weekend, started being reported on, where the New York Times finally reported on the story that broke really about 2 or 3 weeks ago, that a former Joe Biden staffer has accused him of sexual assault. It has been ignored by the corporate media, by all the cable news channels, by all the newspapers, until this weekend when the New York Times wrote a story that they then went in and edited to make more palatable, I guess, to the Biden campaign after they complained, which I've also got a journalistic ethical issue with. But now I've noticed MSNBC has started talking about it. This is, you know, it's an accusation by somebody that worked for Joe Biden for over a year back in the early 90s that at least warrants an investigation. And my problem with it is the hypocrisy from the Democratic Party, from the Biden campaign. These same people who screamed bloody murder about Brett Kavanaugh are ignoring the allegations against Joe Biden. Then they're saying nothing to see here. Move right along. Make this man our nominee. Isn't that just, viscerally, I've got a real problem with that. It hurts my being to say this is the party I'm supposed to get behind and support.
I think, first of all, I find Tara Reid's charges absolutely plausible.
Mm-hmm, so do I.
I find them persuasive. I'm not as troubled by the New York Times. They spent 3 weeks on an investigation. Mm-hmm. That's not something you rush to. Even the edit that they did, if you look closely at it, actually, I would have made the same edit.
Really?
Yeah, okay. The line was wrong.
Okay, so it was an edit saying that he's not...
In other words, if you want to say, we found no... The edit was, they said, we found no pattern of, I think it was, sexual misconduct. And then the extra line was, except for these, I think it was 7 or 8 women who had talked about the ways in which he had touched them inappropriately.
Right.
And so then they cut it to, we found no pattern of sexual misconduct.
Except beyond the hugs, kisses.
Beyond
the hugs, kisses, and touching that women previously said made them uncomfortable. Yeah. And that line was deleted.
You don't do that kind of reporting in a prepositional phrase.
Okay.
You don't. In other words, if we say, okay, we did not find a pattern of sexual misconduct, a legal status. We didn't find that, right? Mm-hmm. That's what we found. Now, then you start a new sentence that says, we did see this, right? But you don't shoehorn things in. And in the same way that Fox News and attacking the New York Times said, and we also noticed that they didn't mention Burisma.
Right.
Why would you mention Burisma? What right. is that? I'm no. sorry. What does that have to do with anything? That the article about Tara Reid's accusations are about Tara Reid accusations.
Gotcha.
They're plenty serious enough, right?
Yes.
So I think there's that. I wholly respect people who say I cannot vote for Biden after that. I don't respect people, I guess I have to say, who say, oh, well, which rapist should I vote for?
Yeah.
As if they've made a point. You should vote for the one who's not actively trying to kill you right now. and you say, well, is that democracy? No, we don't have democracy. We're not. This is what I mean when the hour is late. I'm tired of voting for lesser of two evils. I am too. But we're not in that situation right now.
Right.
If we don't do something about this now, it'll never change. If we don't do something now, we won't be around to see any change.
Right.
It's that bad. We have the president of the United States speaking, I have absolute power. You know, I cover Trump. I just finished a long story about Trump rallies. I've seen Trump rhetoric. You want to talk about the press doesn't recover. When they go to a Trump rally, I just wrote up a rally from Pennsylvania the other night. The press was there, all in their press cage. Trump mm-hmm. joked about staying more than 2 terms, joking, not joking. And that was the only line. They did not cover the must have been 15-minute rant he went on talking about illegal aliens, raping, hacking, carving hearts out, raping, sex crimes. It was hallucinatory in its horror and its monstrosity. And people say, well, I knew Trump was a monster. There's more than one kind of monster. So I'm all for pressing ahead with the investigation and so on, I'm not confident that we're going to knock Biden out as a nominee. I see almost no chance of that. And so I'm going to, which rapist should you vote for? The one who is not this minute trying to kill you, because Trump is waging civil war on the United States right now.
What a position.
Not just on the border, on the whole country and on the whole planet. And Biden will be a monster. Biden will get us into wars. Biden will hurt people, but it will buy a little time. We elect, if Biden's a nominee, we elect him. And the very next day, we start working on that primary in 24 to get him out of office.
Exactly. And we work on while he's there, and what I think Bernie Sanders is doing. And I do know, I mean, I don't have firsthand knowledge, but from what I've read, he worked diligently behind the scenes before he gave up his very valuable endorsement to make sure that he has a voice in this administration or a future Biden administration going forward. I hope Bernie's involved in a VP pick. I hope he's involved in a putting together a cabinet and assembling a platform. I
wouldn't bet on it. I wouldn't bet on it. I mean, look at this is what this Democratic Party is. Of course they're going to screw him. In other words, people say, I don't know, this could go wrong. What do you mean? It could go wrong. It will go wrong. It will go wrong. There's nothing good coming down the pipe politically. So what we can do is hold on. Mm-hmm. What we can do is hold on. Try and survive to build, right? This idea of I'm going to sit it out until there's a good choice.
Yeah, no.
There's going to be a good choice.
No, there's not going to be a good choice. And you're right. We need to staunch the hemorrhaging of everything. I mean, watching that press, whatever, infomercial that the networks willingly give Donald Trump every night and carry it live. I still don't understand why they're doing that. What happened yesterday with this propaganda video, and it was just, that should have been the breaking point. That's when they all should have gotten up and walked out. You're a journalist, Jeff. You're an amazing author, but you're also a journalist. What does this do to your journalistic sensibilities when you see an event like that play out yesterday?
Well, we talked about denial. I think people are in denial. There's people who say, well, okay. I mean, these journalists know what Trump is, but they, you know, respect for the office. It's gone. It's a little bit, you know, it's a little bit in the same kind of rhetoric of like, okay, well, will we be able to get back to normal by June? Or how about July? Can we get back to? No, you're not getting back until there's a vaccine. Mm-hmm. There's no normal, right? And it's a little bit someone, you know, has had a terrible accident, a piano player, they lose a hand and then they recover and they sit down and they try to play the piano and somehow it doesn't sound the same and they're puzzled. You're missing a hand. Exactly. This is where it's at right now. Wow. Trump is not an aberration. He is a fulfillment of something that has been coming for a long time. And he's not the worst. And that's the thing that is so frustrating to me about my left colleagues, friends, comrades, those who are in this, who the naive assumption that this is as bad as it could get. Mm. Nowhere near as bad as it could get. I mean, nowhere near as bad as it could get. I don't think it's at all off the table now that we could be looking, for instance, at arrests of journalists pretty soon. Yeah. I don't think that's out of the range of possibility. We see it happening in other countries that are changing their governments now to enable it. Trump is talking about doing it at his rallies. He floats the possibility. And that's always his method. He says something horrendous. No, I'm just joking. Yeah. Well, maybe until it becomes normalized. Trump is not full fascism. And I think people need to understand that, and they need to do their reading and their understanding of history and maybe visit some fascist countries, because there are some around the world. He is the gateway. The one who comes after Trump will be worse. It's a little bit like, if you think you can pause on Trump, it's like, well, you know, I'm going to wait till we get to 100,000 pandemic deaths before I decide to do anything about it. And by that point, it's too late.
Right. No, in many cases, it's already too late. If we don't stop this now, we had hit rock bottom. We hit the basement before. And then COVID-19 comes up. It's like, okay, we can keep descending. There is no bottom. We've seen that. We need to stop it. And so Jeff Sharlet, I'm there with you all the way. And so now here we are. You're at home in New Hampshire. I'm in South Florida, where through the magic of technology, we're able to talk and even see each other, which is wonderful. But we're still looking for those old comforts. What can we do to entertain ourselves to keep us from losing it mentally? And I think we all have probably moments within every 24-hour period where we probably do. And I got to tell you, I'm so glad I picked up your book. So this is where we segue into the new book. It's called This Brilliant Darkness, A Book of Strangers. And this is a different creature than anything I've seen from you before. Of course, I was introduced to you, as were many of the listeners, by The Family, the book that is now a Netflix series, exposing the family in C Street for all of its creepiness and horrificness. And you wrote a series of short stories. I'm trying to do it from memory.
Sweet Heaven When I Die.
It was right there. And your wonderful reporting that we've read in Rolling Stone and GQ and Esquire and all this. This book is very personal and very different because why don't you tell us, what is This Brilliant Darkness?
This Brilliant Darkness is essentially, it's an account of 2 years of reporting in my life, or roughly 2 years, that sort of bookended by, at the beginning, my father's heart attack. My father was 78 at the time, older than that, and had a heart attack. And I ended up taking care of him. And that changed some of my thinking. Just about 2 years later, as I wrote what I thought was the last sentence of this book, I thought that's the last sentence. I pushed myself away from my desk and I said, I don't feel so good.
Oh my goodness.
And I had a heart attack. And in the aftermath of that, I had to revisit the whole book. But the 2 years in between were a point where I had been reporting, and you mentioned some of these stories. I've been reporting sort of rough stories all my life. I've been interested in difficult people. Mm-hmm. And I had moved from story to story. And what I had not understood, Nicole, was that those stories pile up, they accumulate. Mm-hmm. You go and you absorb terrible stories, you see people in great suffering, and you're grateful that you're just a witness. You don't forget that witness still, it's not the same thing as actually suffering, but it is something. We use that verb. We speak of bearing witness. It's a verb, it's something you carry. And it was putting a weight on me. And so the book was the sort of the reflection of that. The way it was reflected, and this is sort of the unusual part of the book, and there is really no short description of it because it's not an ordinary book.
No, it is not.
It's words and pictures. I'll show it. I don't know if you can see it.
Yeah,
right?
We can. Yes. I've got mine here too. Beautiful.
Snapshots. It began one night. I went where I live. I live in Vermont, across the border from New Hampshire. The only place to work late if you don't want to be at home. Nothing's open late. Dunkin' Donuts. Right. I'm sitting at Dunkin' Donuts. I'm trying to write a magazine story about some of the worst people I've ever written about, the men's rights movement.
I remember we spoke about that story after you wrote it. That was.
Yep. And they were toxic and they were poison. And I'd spend time with them and I couldn't stand it. And I looked up, it was, I don't know, 1 a.m, something like this. And I see the night baker at Dunkin' Donuts. You're showing, right? He's got this t-shirt. And I'm like, wait a minute, that's not really the Dunkin' Donuts uniform, is it? A t-shirt with a big sort of Baroque skull on it. And I get to talking to him.
Awesome.
And it's his last night on the shift and he hates his job. It's last night on the night shift. He's giving it up. And we're just sort of talking about it. And I notice he's got a tattoo of a tear on his eye. And I ask him what that's for. And that's for his child who died very young. And I asked him if I could take his picture. And he said, yes. And I took the picture and I wrote the story. And there was something about that, about telling these stories about everyday people, night shift people, the people who, like me, couldn't sleep, the insomniacs, that gave me a sense of community. I mean, I even remember I typed that out. I put it on Instagram and I hashtagged a night shift and I pressed the hashtag, who else is awake? Well, there's 800,000 people awake. Nurses, cops, warehouse workers. There's a whole genre of night shift pictures where warehouse workers take selfies of themselves getting high, kind of as their fuck you to their bosses. There was this community, and I was able to join this community and And then I sort of ventured, I guess we can talk about it, deeper into it from beyond just the night shift workers to the addicts to the people who are suffering in deeper ways, and trying to see them, take pictures, tell a story, my story about their story. I'm not a voice for the voiceless. This is a very personal book about other people's lives.
Right. You relived, or you went back or returned to some of the stories you worked on. You mentioned the men's rights movement. There was one story that you did when you went to Russia to deal with the LGBTQ community and how they hide. So you had pictures that you took when you were there that you went back and revisited. Is that how that section came about?
Yep. Yeah. So the Russia chapter, and that is actually the chapter that sort of falls outside of that 2-year frame, although it might really be the beginning of this period, when my reporting took mostly for myself, I would say, something of a darker turn. Mm-hmm. And writing about those who were trying to survive in Putin's Russia under this horrific anti-LGBTQ campaign. And I'd written about that for GQ magazine. But part of this came about because, as a reporter, and I think a lot of reporters do this, you know, you've got this powerful little camera in your pocket. And I'm not a photographer, but I'd always studied photography. I came up as a writer studying documentary photography. The documentary projects of the 30s and the 40s were my inspiration. And I would take snapshots. And some of those stories, they didn't fit in the kind of, when you're doing a magazine story, there's a formula, but they were just as important. So there's Zoya, a go-go dancer at a underground gay club in Moscow. And just this person who is lives this sort of double life, a certain amount of terror. Zoya, which is a woman's name, Zoya is a woman, but Zoya must be a man by daylight. And Orface violence and being thrown out on the street and so on. And these were stories that hadn't fit into the larger narrative I was telling, but they lingered with me.
Right.
When I said, you know, the stories that stay with you, these were the stories that stayed, are stories that I wanted to tell and greater depth. So that's in some ways, the whole book is filled with those stories. And each one is not made by, when you read a magazine story, journalists, you know, we speak of, you know, there's a news hook or a peg and so on. There's no news hook or pegs in this book. This is a book of everyday people. This is a book of people living their lives. Even the biggest story in the book, which is about a man named Charlie Africa Kunang.
I was gonna ask you about that. LA, yeah. Homeless man who was killed by police.
Unarmed homeless man killed in on Skid Row in LA, pinned to the ground by a group of cops, shot through the heart, not even a point blank shot, which is a little bit of distance, a contact shot, the muzzle pressed right into the bone while he was spread eagled on the concrete. Not enough people have heard about Charlie for a number of reasons, because Charlie didn't make a good martyr. Charlie was not a promising young man like Michael Brown. He was not just a kid like Tamir Rice. He was not a family man like Eric Garland. Charlie was homeless. He was an addict. He could lose his temper. He was an ex-con. He had been a bank robber. He was high when he died, and it was murder. And I went out there actually to Skid Row. I actually planned to do the same thing I'd been doing, because the official news story was the press and the LA Times and the police said, well, we can know nothing about him. We don't even know his real name. So I thought, I'll just go out to Skid Row and I'll take pictures of the people who lived around them and talk to them. When I got out there, of course, I discovered, no, he had a name.
Yeah.
He had a family. I just, in fact, got an email from his sister this morning.
Wow.
And there was a full story to tell. And so that became, Charlie is in some ways the heart of the book. I think there's a line in the Charlie story, if I can get it right, which is to think about sort of the temptation of tragedy. Charlie's story is tragic, right? Is the illusion of inevitability, this consolation of thinking, well, it couldn't have been otherwise. We look at tragedy. This is, well, it's terrible, but that's just the way it had to be. It never has to be that way. So we had to do two weird things at the same time. Charlie did die. That's not coming back.
No.
I can't save Charlie. But we at the same time must learn from that, wait a minute, at each point in this tragic story, there was another path we could have taken.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what happens, I think, when you look at these everyday lives and you step out of the frame of big journalism sometimes and remember just what it means for someone making a decision right there in that small moment.
You know, the book is called This Brilliant Darkness. And at one point, I noticed a quote from you. I think these are your words. You said, darkness, and I'm paraphrasing, and I'm going to screw up your beautiful words because your words are, you write so beautifully. But basically, darkness is not the absence of light. It's the presence of ink.
You got it. That's it. Yeah.
I love it. And you filled these pages so beautifully. Your writing has always been just something that speaks to me, and I'm obviously many others, whether it's a magazine piece, whether the GQ piece on Russia, everyone should read it. It will change the way you look at, you know, others and what people are struggling. Everyone's got their own shit that they're dealing with in life. And this is a spotlight on a group that I never would have known what they were going through if not for your firsthand storytelling. And so I appreciate that. This brings us to a whole other level, and especially reading it at a time when we're quarantined at home and socially separating, it just touches another part of my soul, certainly. So I got to thank you for this.
I think it is a book for the moment in some ways. I mean, it's about the opposite of social distancing.
Yes.
It's about, you know, getting real close to people that you might not want to get close to. I mean, right. I remember actually there's a guy named Juju Pajuzu, and he was there actually at a demonstration for his best friend, Charlie Afrikunang, had been murdered. But Juju was a really struggled with addiction. He couldn't even stand up when he got to the thing. And he is lying on the sidewalk crying for his friend. Mm. And he wants to talk to me. But he's thrown up beside himself, and he grabs a piece of cardboard and he puts it over the vomit and for me to sit.
Oh, wow.
And that's a gesture, you know? And so I sat, right? It's the opposite of social distancing. At the same time, I don't want to make any like, oh, I'm so unafraid. And I was a broken person at that point. I think of this in terms actually of a line, not from my book, it's a beautiful line. I wish I could take credit for it, but it's not. It's from a book by my friend Leslie Jameson, a recent book called The Reckoning. And she talks about, she's talking about Alcoholics Anonymous. She's writing about her struggle with alcohol and trying to be creative and a writer afterwards. And she uses this phrase for the meeting. She says, the saving alchemy, right?
Mm-hmm.
The transformation of a base material like lead into gold, the saving alchemy of community.
Hmm.
And that to me is what, this book is a record of how that happened for me, of all these people living difficult lives, some of them very difficult people, were willing to talk with me in the middle of the night oftentimes and share stories and let me tell stories about their lives, let me share their image and so on. That's the saving alchemy of community. And I have to say, you know, the book published February 11th.
Yeah.
I got to do some events. And then, of course, I had to cancel most of the book tour. And, you know, I'm lucky. I've published a lot of books. It's a little bit like publishing into a pandemic is dropping a book down a well, right?
Yeah.
The book is never going to have the life it was going to have.
No.
But I've gotten these notes from some people who are reading it in quarantine. Some people, like, I took it out from the library right before I went into quarantine. Now I can't get back. And they're picking that up. And that is very moving to me. It's like, I'm here and I can't be near other people. And I want a book that is about connecting with people, but I'm not looking for anything saccharine right now.
Right, right.
And I think some of us need saccharine, and I don't, if that's what you need, if you need some sugar, that's it. This book is probably not going to be it. The hope of the book is in the cover, which is, that to me is the hope of the book. And I do think it's a hopeful book, but it is not hope. It is not hope easily gotten. That's a burning car. I was coming back from reporting a trip, and it was a very dispiriting it was just a bitter reporting trip, and some of these stories were too rough. And I came back, and I was driving along, and I was feeling crushed. And I saw that car burning, and I pull over, and there's only one other person there at the time, and it's a meth addict. He's tweaking. He's full on high. He's shaking, and he's doing something to my mind deeply heroic, which is he's there waiting for the cops so he can tell them the fact that there's someone in that car.
Oh, wow.
Beyond saving. And look, he's high. He knows he's as clearly high as it can be. He can be arrested. And a young cop comes and we watch the car burn. You couldn't get anywhere near it.
Wow.
There was no saving anybody. The sorrow of that was that the next day, the local newspaper reported that the cop, who must have been 22, 23, rushed into the flames to try and rescue the person. And I thought they kind of shamed him in doing that, because that wasn't possible. And by imagining that we have power that we don't, we obscure what we can do. What that man did was he bore witness. That's all that was left at that point. And that's not easy. In fact, that's so hard. You could see that his police department, they couldn't bear to think that sometimes you have to recognize what is lost, but you can bear witness. You can have the courage to see another, which is what that cop did, which is what that tweaker did, which is maybe a situation that we are in right now. You know, we have this great frustration. This Trump, I can't stand him. You know what? Something's got to give. 25th Amendment. That's not going to happen.
No.
That's not going to happen. You're called upon to endure and to bear witness. That's what we can do.
And absolutely. This Brilliant Darkness, A Book of Strangers is the title, by Jeff Sharlet. And I got to say, as much as I'm loving the content, the book itself is beautiful. The way it's put together, and a book featuring so many photos, I got to say, would usually be prohibitively expensive for a lot of people, but they found a way to do this quality paper, beautiful book for $25, which...
The way, Nicole, was, I'm very proud of this, the way was I gave up my royalties.
Oh.
it is. This book should be, I don't know,
a lot more.
$5. Yes. I mean, yep. It's beautiful paper.
It's beautiful.
And so on.
Really,
but
nice.
I also was like, I didn't want to make this book. I wanted it to be something that people could get. I have the good fortune of, I teach at a college, so I'm still going to be able to, you know, pay my bills. I said it was more important for me for it to be published right.
Hmm.
And I had to say, look, it's got to be color too. There's meaning in the color. Some people have chosen color in their lives. Some people, the color of their clothing. There's one woman, an addict in Dublin, and she had these sort of beautiful blue eyes, and she was sitting in front of a pink building. And I asked if I could take her picture, and she said yes. And then we're scrolling, looking at the pictures I had taken of her, and she said, that one. And
wow.
And I said, what is it? She says, the eyes.
Huh.
The eyes. Not my eyes, the eyes. You know, she had been greatly reduced in life, but she knew she had these beautiful blue eyes. Well, I want you to see those blue eyes. I had a wonderful publisher and a wonderful editor that I worked with before, but you're right, prohibitively expensive. And I said, I'll tell you what, I will give up my royalties. But we've got to do it this way. And then Norton, the publisher, they said, okay, this is going to cost us too, but let's just make a beautiful thing. Let's make a beautiful object. So I'm really grateful to them.
And it is. And I'll tell you, Jeff, I have a deal with listeners. I started a Patreon page because this is a new kind of a gig economy. We're trying to feel our way through. And one of my perks for donors is when you hear an interview with an author, first come, first serve. You want the book, you got it. I'm keeping this one.
Good.
I am keeping this one. But it is available.
I'll tell you what, I will send a copy. First come, first serve, I will send a copy to someone.
Awesome. All right. I will let you know who it is. So that's a deal. But go out and get or order it.
Don't
go
home.
Out. Order it online. Amazon's still shipping books, as are other booksellers.
There's a new service. It's just opened, actually. I think it's called Bookshop.
Okay.
It's It's something that they've been trying to do. It's a platform for independent bookstores. No, it's bookstore. Let me
check.
I'm going
to find it, and I think I signed up for it because I can put links on my site because I don't do Amazon links. I'm going to find it, and I'll put that link on the blog. And it is the bookstore or bookshop.com. I'll find it and put it up there. And yes, I can't recommend this highly enough, especially with what we're going through right now. It's just beautiful, Jeff Sharlet. And thank you so much for the work you're doing, you continue to do, for telling the truths you tell, and for being such an inspiration. I'm such a big fan of yours, and I really appreciate your time today.
Thank you, Nicole. It's great talking with you.
Always great to talk with you, too. Thank you so much. Stay safe. Hug those children, and we will talk again soon, I'm sure. Thank you. Jeff Sharlet, he really, I hope you enjoyed that as much as I did. Look, I did the interview yesterday, but I just listened to it again. I buy that book. All right, so first person to get through on my email, Nicole@NicoleSandler.com, asking for a copy of This Brilliant Darkness from Jeff Sharlet, will get a copy from him, because I'm keeping this one. I'll give you the details later on about, in another subsequent show about the first come, first serve program for books. But if you're looking to buy it, wait a few minutes and then go to NicoleSandler.com/4-15-20, today's show. I will post the link. It is bookshop.org, a great alternative to Amazon when you're buying books. All right, so I'll put a link up there from that bookseller to purchase Jeff's book and any others you might be interested in. And yes, I do get a small commission if you buy anything through my links. So it's another way to help the show. And with that, we come to the end of another program. Thank you for listening, everyone. I'll be back tomorrow. We will do some quarantine calling tomorrow. And it's Thursday, so Howie Klein will be here. Stay safe. Take care. Wash your hands. Stay inside. And I'll talk to you tomorrow. Thanks for listening, everyone. We too shall get through this, or something like that. This too shall pass. I'm so bad at cliches. All right, I'll see you tomorrow. Bye.